Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this session. As we look at the issue that deals with the Holy Spirit, we pray that you may guide us. The same Spirit that was in prophets and the writers of the Bible may also give us the right interpretation of the verses we are looking at. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. We want to look at the issue of the Spirit more, a little bit more in depth. This Spirit that we are talking about, whose Spirit is it? Because this is another issue that gives us a lot of problems.
Yeah.
So, look at the book of Matthew chapter 16. The book of Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. Are we there?
Yes.
Look at verse... let us read from verse 13 down to verse 17.
When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea,
yes,
Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?"
So many people have been talking about Jesus is this, Jesus is that, Jesus is this, Jesus is that. And then Christ approaches his disciples and ask them, what what do the people say the Son of Man
is?
Verse 14.
Some say John the Baptist.
Yes.
Others say Elijah.
Yes.
And still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets.
So the people are answering Jesus, the disciples are answering Jesus Christ who people say he is. Either he is Elias, either he is the Jeremiah, either he is John the Baptist, or others, another one of the prophets. And Jesus asks something so important in verse 15. You have told me what people say I am, but you yourself, the people, the 12 that I am with, what do you say I am? Read verse 15.
But what about you?
You have heard people saying a lot of things. But what about you guys? What do you say I am? Then verse 16 says what?
Simon Peter answered.
Yes.
You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God.
You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Now listen carefully what Christ tells Peter. What does he tell him?
Then Jesus replied,
yes.
Blessed are you.
Blessed are you, not cursed are you.
No.
You have said I'm the Son of the living God. You are blessed.
Simon,
yes.
Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven.
So this has been revealed to you
By my father
who is
in heaven.
Now you ask, the Father is in heaven, Christ is on earth with his disciple, and how has Jesus, how the Father revealed this thing to Peter? Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. Start from verse 16 to get the context until verse 20. Let us now listen. Let us now see the Father is in heaven, but he's revealing something to Peter. In which way? Start from verse 16 downwards.
I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves.
Yes.
Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves.
Yes.
Be on your guard, you will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say.
At that time, you will be given what
to say.
Now, see how they will be given what to say in verse 20.
For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you.
So, it will not be you who is speaking, but who?
The Spirit of the Father
doing what?
Speaking through you.
So, who revealed to Peter who Jesus Christ was?
The Spirit of God.
The Spirit of the Father.
Yeah.
Is the one that revealed to Peter that Jesus Christ is the Son of the Living God. So, go to 1 John chapter 5, where actually now you have a question that about what is in 1 John chapter 5, that this is speaking about the Trinity maybe. 1 John chapter 5. Now let us see it. Verse 6. This is that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. So, whose spirit? God's spirit, and it is the same spirit that he has given to his son. Did we read that in John 3:34? He that God has sent, he giveth his spirit without measure. So the Father gave the Son the Spirit, and the Son gave those who wrote the Bible the Spirit. We read that in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 11. The Spirit of Christ in them was bearing witness. And so, this is the text that has been used many times to prove that there is a Trinity. And in verse 7 says, and in the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the
Spirit.
And these are
one.
Now, I can talk. Yes, go ahead, my brother.
What we call or we refer the Holy Spirit as He?
That is a good question. Yeah, that's a good question. Why do we call the Spirit He? And why is it called it? Can you call a human being it?
No.
You cannot put a preposition of it to a human being. But yet the Spirit is called
it
and it's called He. So we can answer those two questions.
Yeah.
So let us continue with this verse that is used to prove a Trinity. Is this verse
is
really saying about Trinity?
I want you to strike the nail on the head.
Yes.
And now the Bible, as my brother read, that it is in them. And sometimes the theologians, they are being taught that you can't call the Holy Spirit it.
Yes.
Because it's a person.
No, but it's the Bible it. In fact, I'll show you another verse. So, I'll just give you another verse. No, leave alone 1 John chapter 5, verses 9. I want to give you another verse which says the Holy Spirit is it. So, the book of Romans. The book of Romans, and before we come to back to those two questions. Look at verse 26, Romans chapter 8. Because we are looking at these two things, he and it. Verse 27.
And he who saddens our heart, that knows the mind of the Spirit. Because the Spirit exists for God's people in accordance with the will of God.
There's something which is not in the Bible.
Which? I said that the NIV defines the
NIV is not a good Bible for Bible study. But now we are doing a Bible study and your verses are not reading as they should read. Listen to what it says in another verse. Yes.
Now, he who suggests the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
That one also misses something. But this says, likewise, I don't know if this is King James Version. Take this, Romans. I want you to notice this, because the other versions skip writing what should be written. Open Romans 8:27 in King James Version. Can you read 8:26 of your Bible?
26, in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. So we do not know what he ought to pray for. But the Spirit himself
intercedes
for
it. Says the Spirit itself. So the Spirit is called it. Are you seeing that? Now it is there in verse 26. The Spirit itself. So the Spirit is it. And it is him. That is what we are going to see as we continue. So I wanted just to show you that verse. Let us go back to 1 John chapter 5.
The same as
in yeah, King James, it is itself. So, verse 7. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Ghost, and these three are
one.
So, in heaven, we have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Yes? But it is not telling us there are three gods.
They are one.
The Spirit is there to
bear witness. The Bible is saying, if that verse has to be accepted, it is saying that it bears record or witness.
Yes.
It convicts. It bears record. You understand what we are saying?
Yeah.
Witness. It witnesses. It convicts. Because the Spirit was in them. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
It was in the prophets. It bears witness. But whose Spirit is it?
What is Spirit?
The Father's Spirit, he also gave the Son, and now it is in those who are created or creatures. So they are one. When I say Peter and Sarah are one, what do I mean?
You say
we are the
body
of Christ.
What will I be meaning in on a basic level?
Of the same.
They have one thinking.
They have one thought. They are speaking one thing.
Yeah.
Because if you appear in the court and the judge says, you know, Peter and Sarah are one.
Yeah.
Because here it's a record being given. It's like it is before a people's endure.
Yeah.
And you speak something, he speaks something, and she speaks something.
Yeah.
And we say they are one.
Yeah.
Do I mean that all the people who spoke are men?
No.
Do I mean they are all female?
No.
I just say they are one. Sindhio?
Yeah.
And so, this is not to mean that the three are God. We should read the Bible the way it is. It doesn't say that the three are one God. It says they bear one record, one witness, which means that what the Father says, the Son will testify that, and the Holy Spirit will testify that, because it is the Spirit of the Father. So the Father cannot say something and then the Spirit bears witness in somebody which is different. It will bear the same thing because it is the Spirit of what? Of God. And so, but there's a lot of controversy on 1 John chapter 5 verse 7. It is not in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of controversy that it was not there in the Bible, but it was added. But I'll not go to that extent. It's a long study. But even looking at the verse, whether it was added or not added, it is not saying that there are three gods and they are one God. There are three persons and they are one God. That's not what the Bible is saying. You should read the way it reads. The thing is that they bear record. And this record is one. Verse 8, and there are three that bear witness in earth, the spirit and the water and the blood. How does the spirit bear record on earth? Or witness on earth?
To witness that Jesus died on the cross and risen.
That is the conviction it brings to our heart.
Yeah.
Jesus died on the cross for our sins.
Yeah.
And the water and the blood signifies he is the one that cleanses us from our sins.
And they agree as one.
These agree as one. What the water symbolizes is also what the blood symbolizes. It is what the spirit symbolizes. By day, you know, we are sanctified by the spirit. We are cleansed by the water. We are purified by the blood. They do one thing. Their record is one, our sanctification, our salvation. And it is the spirit of the Father through the Son to us. This is the record that we have been given. So, if we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater, for this is the witness of God, which he hath testified of his Son. So, the whole of John, 1 John chapter 5, is about witness. It's about the record that Christ is the Son of God. And it is only through him that we have our salvation. Through him that we have eternal life. Now, try to think this. Look at verse 7. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. I want you brothers and sisters to think this. If you say that now these are three people that makes up one God, you will find a problem in verse 8. Because look at verse 8, and there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, water and blood. Now this also agree in one. So tell me, this water, blood and spirit, what are they? Another God on earth made up of three. If you say in heaven we have the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, and because they are, these three are one, it means one God. Are you understanding what I'm saying? On earth we have the water, the blood, and the spirit. What will you say they are? Another one God on earth, made up of three things. No. If you have to be consistent enough, you have to get what verse 7 is saying and verse 8 is saying. Although, I'm telling you, verse 7 and 8, it is something which is debated. You go to the commentaries, Bible commentaries, you will find that these are verses that actually someone was translating the Bible, and because the Greek language and all these things, there was what we call Johannine comma, he added there, which was an interpolation or an addition of what was in the verse. But even to a basic Bible student, when you look at the verses, that is not what it's saying, that there are three that are one God. There are three that bear record, witness that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
As you have told us that there's something which was added there, because we know that the NIV is a divide, Wood Music is a divide in some verses there in off from the Bible. And I know that in the Chinese version, the authorized King James Version, it is not defined as I...
It's not much corrupted like other versions.
Okay. So, which sentence would be filled here and was taken off so that you can... You know, my brother, this is what I had been
teaching some people in my village and outside of my village. Those ones whom I know that they are the reliable ones.
Yes.
And as that Christian was coming here and there, the Trinity, the Trinion, which first was moved from this, this chapter 5, verse 7. Which
so,
as you have told us.
The best way you can deal with the verse is that just to stick to what the verse is saying and not what the verse is not saying. The verse doesn't say these are three gods. It says that these three bear record.
Yeah.
So it will help the people not start doubting the Bible has this and the Bible has this. But concerning that verse and asking actually what is written there, the verse should read like this. I'll give you in a moment what the verse. It's a long topic, and if God allows, we shall read this so that you may have it. Look for hope I get it what it should be written there. Just a moment. This is how the verse should read, verse 7 going down to verse 8. It should read, for there are three that bear record, the spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree in one.
That is the verse that you should
read. So the verse should read, from verse 8 down, from verse 7 to 8, it should read that for there are three that bear record, the spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree in one. What was added is this: in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one.
Okay.
Yes. So what was added is, in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one, and there are three that bear witness on earth. That is added. What the verse should read in original is, for there are three that bear record, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one. But leave alone that, the text itself doesn't say that these are three gods in one. You have just to understand how it reads, without even telling people that it is something that is added.
Mm-hmm.
This is the original reading.
Mm-hmm.
So, with that said, I'd like us to cover something about the Holy Spirit. Briefly, about whose spirit is it. Now, you will find it is interesting, the best place to start studying the issue of the Holy Spirit is where the Spirit is promised itself. So let us go back to John chapter 14, because that is where the Spirit is promised. Let us go to John chapter 14, where it is interesting the Spirit is promised. John chapter 14. And I'll give you the verse when you read it there. The book of John chapter 14. Let us start from verse 1. We shall just go slowly by slowly. It says, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Verse 3. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Verse 5. Thomas says unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Verse 6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way,
the
truth and
life.
No man cometh unto the Father but so between Jesus and the Father, how many people are in between? No. Between Jesus and the Father, how many people do we have?
One.
Can you repeat that again before?
No one comes.
That's verse five. No one comes.
No, verse 6.
Verse 6. Okay.
Jesus say unto him, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So this is the question I'm asking. Between the Father and the Son, how many people in between?
There are one.
No, then you don't understand. Yeah? What are you saying?
No,
there is no one between the Father and the Son. I hope you are understanding. This is the Father and this is the Son. In the middle, who is there?
No.
Are you understanding what I'm saying? I'm asking. Between the Father and the Son, do we have anyone in between? There is no one in between. Now,
and he is saying that I'm the truth, as we were just saying here, that the Spirit bears truth.
Yes.
So he is just confirming that although I'm speaking of the Spirit, I'm the truth.
I'm the truth.
Yeah.
We are coming to that point. So we have between the Father and the Son, we have no one in between.
Yeah.
Now, between the Father and the sinners, how many people do we have in between? Who is that? It is Jesus. No one comes to the Father but by? Now, between the Son and the sinners, how many people in between?
The Holy Spirit
is there now.
We have the Father, the Son. But if you have, you say between the Father and between the Son and the sinners, we have the Holy Spirit. Again, unless you can explain it.
No. May I contradict this myself?
Yes.
According to the teaching that the Son, in between the Son and the believers, or many people, we have just only God.
There is nobody.
We have the people, Jesus Christ and the Father.
Jesus Christ is the mediator. So
he is the mediator. He is the link on that side and he is the link on this side. So this is what happens. We have the Father, the sinners and Jesus Christ in between. There is something that he receives from the Father and he gives to the sinners. And the character of these people is reflected to the Son, to the Father. And the whole process is what we are looking at. Now, look at verse 7. Jesus, verse 6 says, I am the truth, the way, and life. Verse 7, if you had known me, you should have known my Father also, and from henceforth you know him and have seen him. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, as it is suffices us. Jesus said unto him, have you been so long time with you, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father, and how sayest thou then, shew us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the... Verse 10. Believest thou not that I am in the... In the Father, and the Father in... The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doth the works.
Yeah.
So, Christ is in the Father, and the Father is in?
In him.
And the words he speaks are not his words, but the words of them. Now, who revealed to Peter what to speak? The Spirit of who?
Of the Father.
Peter. Whose spirit was it?
From the Father.
From the Father, because Jesus Christ was with them on the earth. And he told them, Jesus Christ is telling Peter, flesh and blood has not revealed unto you, but the Father who is in heaven. And it is by the Spirit. And so the same Spirit is also in Jesus Christ, because Christ is saying, my words are not mine, but they belong to the Father. In which way? The Spirit of the Father is in him. Verse 11. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very works' sake. 12. Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the work that I do shall he do also, and greater works than this shall he do, because I go unto the Father. And whosoever shall, you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I'll do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. Verse 16. Let us read together. Here is where the matter starts.
Yeah.
Because now he's telling them about something that from verses 1 to verses 15, you don't find the Spirit. He's talking about the Father, the Son, the Father, the Son.
Yeah.
Now he introduces another thing so different from what he has been speaking. Verse 16. And I will do what?
And I will pray.
And I'll pray
the Father.
The Father.
He will give you another.
Another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Take notice of the words of Jesus Christ. We'll pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you
forever.
Now, pause for a minute. He's saying that I'll ask of the Father another comforter. We don't have to go outside John to get the answer of what he's saying. But for the sake of it, I want you just to hold there and go to Acts chapter 2, verses 33. What did Jesus Christ promise them?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit, the Comforter, is it? Yes. Acts chapter 2, verse 33. Are you there? What does it say? Yes.
Exalted on the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and has poured out what you now see and hear.
Now, NIV is so not so good. NIV is not a good buy, Mama. You have to buy a buy. King James Bible. You will have to buy one. If you have to do good Bible studies, you will have to buy a King James Bible study. It says, and you have received what? Read again. I want just to hear it from NIV. Just Mama read it.
Okay. It says, exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit. And
he has received from the Father the promised Holy
Spirit.
When he was going away, what did he promise the disciples?
The Comforter.
The Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is it? And now, Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, he says that I have received the The promise. This is what he promised the disciples. He promised the Holy Spirit. And he received it. He receives it from who?
From the Father.
And he now gives to the disciples on the day of Pentecost. He said that whatever you will ask, he says that I'm going away. I'll pray the Father and he shall give you another comforter. He is promising the Holy Spirit. And on the day of Pentecost, he receives the promise. Now read it in King James 2:33.
It says,
yes.
Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit,
uh-huh.
he poured out this which you now see and hear.
So that is good news.
Yeah.
Which version?
Gideon's. Yeah.
Yes. It leaves out something. He receives the promise and sheds it out, pours it out.
Yeah.
So that is an established fact that Christ received the promise from the Father. And then he poured out to the people. So go back to John chapter 14.
But there's something I'm confused about.
Yes, go ahead.
About Genesis 1-2.
Okay, we will come to that.
Yeah.
We are coming to that. Very soon we are coming to that. So, I want you to see Brother Peter in verse 16, and Sister Sarah and Brother Peter.
Yeah.
And I'll pray the Father, and he shall give you the Comforter, that he may abide with you for ever. And in Acts, we are told that he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father. Now, verse 17. What does it say in your Bible, Gideon?
The Spirit of that word,
yes,
whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be with you.
Now, I hope English is not a very difficult language.
Yeah.
He says that I'll send you another comforter from the Father.
Yeah.
Acts chapter 2:33 says that he received the promise from the Father.
Yeah.
But I told you we don't have to go outside John to know what is being spoken. Verse 17 says that even the spirit of what?
Truth.
Now you have to ask yourself, who is truth?
The Father.
No, according to the book of John, we have been reading.
Say that I am the truth, the truth, and the
life.
I am the truth, the way, and
life.
No one comes to the Father but by. So, who is the truth?
Jesus
Christ. And what is he sending?
The comfort.
Use the words that are there. The spirit of what?
Truth.
Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I am the truth.
Yeah.
And I'll send you the spirit of?
Truth.
Whose spirit then?
Jesus Christ.
The spirit of Christ, because he is the truth.
Yeah.
The spirit of the truth shall be sent unto you.
Yeah.
Now, notice something else. But you know him, for he does what? Verse 17, I'm still in verse 17.
Yeah. Okay. The spirit of the truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him.
Yes.
But you know him, for he dwells with you and in you.
He dwells
with you.
With you.
Yeah.
Now, in NIV, what does it say? Verse 17.
John.
The spirit of the truth, the world cannot accept him, because it neither sees him, knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you, and I will be in you.
So now, be attentive. Now I want you to listen carefully. The Spirit of Truth,
who lives,
who the world cannot see because it sees Him.
Yeah.
The Spirit was it, and now here it is being referred to
Him.
Him
is a person now.
Now it's a person.
Yes.
But the preposition it cannot apply to a person.
And if we continue, it says He dwells with you. He dwells
now
with you.
The Spirit
dwells.
He does what?
Dwells.
Dwells
with you.
And
they will be in you.
Who was dwelling with the disciples?
Jesus.
Who was living with them?
That was Jesus.
Jesus was living with them. He says that the Spirit of Truth, because He, Jesus Christ, dwelleth with you. But when I go away, I'll be
in you.
In you.
Yeah.
Are you seeing that?
Yeah.
He that was with them physically now will be in them spiritually.
Yeah.
It is one person. It and He. And why is the Spirit now called it? Because it is not, it doesn't have a body. It doesn't have this body. It is the mind, the character, and the personality of Jesus Christ, the Father, in them. He was dwelling with them physically, but when He goes away, like our spirit, we are human beings, our spirit cannot go out of us and we remain alive. But Jesus Christ and the Father are God. And one of their attributes, that their spirit, they can send forth their spirit, their personality, their character, to be in us. And so, who was doing, in fact, verse 18, what does it say?
I will not leave you as orphans. I come to you.
Now, King James says, I'll send you a comforter. Send you?
Yeah.
Now read verse 17, verse 18.
18 says, I will not leave you orphans, I will come to you.
That is why the other versions are not consistent.
I will come to you.
So who is coming to them even before we look at King James? Who is coming to them? I want this brother and sister to understand. Who is coming to them?
Jesus.
Look at King James. I'll send you another comforter. Alos. But I'll not leave you.
Yeah.
In fact, I'll send you another comforter and He will be with you forever. Take notice of the words. Another comforter and I'll be with you forever. And He will be with you forever. Now verse 18, what does it say, Mama?
It says, I will not leave you comfortless.
Mm-hmm.
I come to you.
So, I'll send another comforter.
Yeah.
And me, myself, Jesus Christ, I'll not leave you comfortless.
Yeah.
I, myself, I'll do what? So, Christ is coming to them as a comforter. But in a spiritual way, not in a physical way now.
Yeah.
He is manifesting Himself in a spiritual way in their lives. Now, you know, those people never understood what He was saying, the way many people don't understand. But it is good it was written so that we may understand. It says in verse, yet a little while and the world seeth me no more, but you see me because I live, you shall live also. I'm in verse 19. I hope I'm not going too fast.
Number 19.
Yes.
Because
yet a little while and the world seeth me no
more.
But ye see me.
Because I live.
Ye shall live also.
Verse 20.
At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father and ye in me.
And I in
you.
In you. So it is Christ in them. In which way?
Through
through the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
It is not another God or another person. Am I forming my own words?
No.
Am I speaking my own words?
No.
No, the Bible is speaking what is there. We are reading the Bible itself. Let no one interpret the Bible for you. Read what is in the Bible and accept it. Don't accept another interpretation. He says that I'll send you another comforter. Yet I'll not leave you comfortless. I'll come to you. And you shall know I am in the Father and in you. Now, verse 21. How will Christ and the Father be in the believer? Verse 21.
He that hath my commandments.
He that hath my commandments.
And keepeth them. He keepeth them.
Yes.
He it is that loveth me.
Yes.
And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father.
Yes.
And I love him and manifest myself unto him.
Yes. And so they are saying, if you love my word, me and my Father, we shall come and manifest ourselves in you.
Yeah.
We are physically in heaven. You cannot see us with your eyes. But the effects of our work in you shall be manifest. Everyone shall know that you are in the Father, and the Father is in me, and I am in you.
Yeah.
Through the Spirit. And when the Spirit comes in us, it produces the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5:25, humility, love, meekness. These are the attributes of the Father and the Son. It is not another God in us producing the fruit of the Spirit. No, it is that, in fact, to go to heaven, you must have the character of the Father and the Son. Now, can another person who is not the Father and the Son produce the, can another person who is not Peter produce the character of Peter?
No.
No, it is only Peter who can produce his character. He produce his character. Yeah? Like, I cannot have children who have the DNA of Brother Peter.
No.
Do you understand that?
Yes.
So can we have the DNA of the Father, the fruit of the Father and the Son in us, when it is not their Spirit working in us? It is impossible. You cannot have the DNA of another person if you are not from that person. And so it is the Spirit of the Father and the Son in us. And so, Judas never understood this thing. Look at what verse 22 says.
Judas said unto him, not Isaacariot, Lord, how is that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us,
and not unto
the world?
Jesus answered and said unto him,
If a man love me,
if a man love me,
he will keep my words.
He will keep my words.
And my Father will love him.
Yes.
And he will come unto him and make our abode with him.
Yes. So if you love my word, we will come, me and my Father, and make our abode, make a dwelling place in you. In fact, it says that we are the temple of God. Have you ever seen that verse? 1 Corinthians 3:16? That our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit of God? Yeah. So when we love the Lord, when we love Jesus Christ, we keep his word, and the Father and the Son comes and dwells in us. Our bodies become the temple of God. It means that this shell of flesh is now housing the very mind and character of God, the very Spirit of God. Do you see how that wonderful is? And that is how sin is dealt with, the Father and the Son dwelling in us. They do away with sin by their Spirit. 1 Thessalonians 2:13 says that we are sanctified by that Spirit.
Yeah.
And John 6:63 says that the words are life.
1 Thessalonians
2:13. So the Spirit of the Father and the Spirit of the Son, it is sent to us. So Jesus, when he is saying that I'll send you another comfort, I'll send you the Spirit, he's not talking about anyone else. He says that I'll be in you. I have been with you, but I'll be in you.
Yeah.
I'll not leave you comfortless. I'll come in you and be with you. Now, I want just to introduce something so important. In verse 16, it says, and I'll pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Now, my brother, I want you to, and sister, I want you to hold that word forever.
Yeah.
And go open the book of Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. If you reach there, you say amen. 28. Verses 18 to 20.
It says, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make the disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age.
So he says that I'll send you the Comforter and he will be with you for? Forever.
Yeah.
Matthew chapter 28 says that I am with you always. The Comforter is with you forever. Jesus Christ is saying, I am with you always.
Yeah.
Same thing. It is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He is the one in us. And maybe just to add another verse. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Verses 10 to verse 15. Let us read these things with understanding. Let us read them slowly. Let us think about what we are reading, because we are told, sanctify them with the truth. Your word is
truth.
So we are sanctified by truth. As we read this word, we are getting the truth and we are being sanctified. Satan cannot take away our sanctification if we believe in truth. Verse 10. I want you to just go at your pace. 8 verse 10.
And if Christ be in you.
And if Christ be
in you.
How is Christ in you? If I may ask you.
Through the
Spirit. And it is His Holy Spirit. Not just through the Holy Spirit, but His Spirit. So, continue. The body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of
righteousness.
So, Christ in you, by His Spirit, produces righteousness.
Yeah.
This is the practical aspect of learning the doctrine about God and His Son. Christ in you produces righteousness through His Spirit. Verse 11.
But if the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelt in Him.
Yes, so the Spirit of the Father that was in Christ and raised Him from the dead, it is the same Spirit sent through the Son to us, and it quickens us from the dead. It is the Spirit that will resurrect us, the Spirit of the Father, shed forth through the Son. It will, first of all, do away with sin, help us overcome sin. Then, at resurrection, if we lie down today and die, and sleep the rest, then the Spirit will raise us, the glory of the Father will raise us. Verse 12.
Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live under the flesh. Flesh is dying, but if we through the Spirit to mortify the deeds of the body,
you shall live. For as many
as are led by the Spirit of God,
they are sons of God. They are led by the Spirit of who? Of God, not God the Holy Spirit. They are led by the Spirit of who?
Of God.
In them, it is given unto us through the Son. As we are led with it, then we become the sons of God. Verse 15.
For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again, to tear, to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption. Adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father.
Yes, so we have received the spirit of adoption, and what does it cry?
Abba, Father.
Abba,
Father.
The spirit we have received cries, Abba,
Father.
Let us ask the Bible, whose spirit is it that cries, Abba, Father, in us? Galatians 4:6. Six.
Six.
Yes.
And because ye are sons.
And because ye are sons,
God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father.
So, whose spirit is in us? Yes.
God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts,
crying
out, Abba, Father.
In Romans chapter 8, verse 14, we are told, for as many as led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are sons of
God.
And the Spirit in them cries, Abba, Father. And when you go to Galatians 4:6, it says that because you are son, the Father has sent the Spirit of who? Of the Son, crying what? Abba, Father. So it is the Spirit. The Father gives the Spirit to the Son, and the Son gives us the Spirit. Are you seeing that? In Romans chapter 8, it says that the Spirit of God. In Galatians 4:6, it says the Spirit of the Son. And people can think that there are two spirits. You can think it is two spirits, but it is? It is from the Father to the Son to us. That is the Holy Spirit. We don't have anything that is called the Trinity of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We have the Father, his Son, and their Holy Spirit. Now you are asking something, brother. And I know that there are so many things to learn about the Holy Spirit. It's not a subject that we can start now and end now. I'll just accept your questions. But you have asked about, when we are beginning, you asked about, you would like to know something about John, the book of Genesis.
Yeah, 1:2.
Yes, go there and read it for us. We go there. Genesis.
I read.
Yes, the verses that you are talking about.
That the earth was without form.
Yes.
And void, and the darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the water.
Now, I hope you have read clearly your Bible.
Yeah.
The earth was without form. It was void, and what?
Darkness.
And darkness was over the face of the deep.
And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters.
What was hovering over the water?
The Spirit
of God.
Not God, the Holy Spirit.
The Spirit of God.
It was what?
Spirit of
the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God. So if I say the Spirit of Peter, what do I mean? Is it somebody else I'm talking about?
Yeah.
No. Peter, if I say your spirit, do I mean another person?
You are not speaking about somebody else.
Yes. I'm speaking about you yourself, your spirit.
Yeah.
Human beings cannot send forth the spirit outside themselves, but God can be able to do that. So it is the Spirit of God, not God the Holy Spirit. So somebody cannot say that God the Holy Spirit was moving around on the waters. It is the Spirit,
the Spirit of God.
But I want you to also notice what it says about Genesis chapter 1 verse 2. What was this that was moving about? We are told that the Spirit of God was moving about the waters. If you want to learn about the Bible, you look in the Bible what it talks about it. Go to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms. book of Psalms and giving you the verse here. When he talks about the Spirit of God was over the waters, what do we mean? I'll give you some two verses. Psalms 29, are you there?
Yeah.
Verses 3 and 2 verses 5.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters.
The voice of the Lord is upon
the waters.
So Genesis says that the Spirit of God was upon the waters, is it? And Psalm says, what was upon the waters?
The Spirit. The voice of the Lord.
The voice of
the Lord.
The Lord is over the waters. Continue to read.
The word of the Lord thundered. The Lord is upon my waters.
Is upon many waters. Verse.
The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaketh the cedars. Ye, the Lord breaketh the cedars of Lebanon.
So, what was upon the water?
The voice of the Lord.
We have there, Mama, you got it. We have the power of God, the voice of God. So, the Spirit is the power. And it is the voice of God. And it was upon the waters.
Yes.
Which means that actually the Holy Spirit is the power of God. It is His voice. But also Psalms, it's another thing. Psalms 33. Verses 6.
By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth.
So the Spirit of the Lord is also the word of God. The Spirit of God is also his word. When he speaks forth, the word carries that spirit. It's a mechanism. You cannot separate the word of God and his spirit. Because in John 6:63 we are told that the words that I speak unto you are spirit and life. So, your question, I hope it's being answered. The Spirit of the Lord was upon the waters. The voice of the Lord. The power of God. The word of God. These are the attributes of God. And when it was upon the waters, he spoke and things came to be. That is how he created the heavens and the earth, and not anything else. And so, I don't know if we have any other question on the spirit, or we break.
Before we break,
yes.
Psalms 62 verse 11. And Acts 1 verse 18 says that the Spirit is all powerful. Which is this Spirit? The Spirit of God or the Spirit of Jesus Christ?
Let us go to first. It was Isaiah or Psalms?
Psalms 62 verse 11. God has spoken once, twice. Have I heard this? That power belonging unto God.
Yes.
The power, the spirit, the powers to belongs to what? To who? Is God the God or the Son?
Yes.
Belonging to God.
God has spoken once, twice. I
have. Acts 1:18.
but power belongs to God.
Yeah. Power belongs unto God.
Just read what you are reading and then we get clear what we can say. The power,
yeah,
it says, belongs. God hath spoken once, twice have I heard this, that the power belong to
God.
And to God. Then go to
there's no question.
There's no question.
Yeah.
Go to Acts chapter 1, verse 8.
Chapter 1, verse 18.
Of
Acts chapter 1.
You know, somebody asked a question that,
yes,
the spirit is omnipresent. Omnipotent, not omnipresent, but omnipotent.
Omnipotent, all powerful. Yes.
That's what I was just trying to ask. Is the spirit omnipotent and evil is omnipotent? The attribute of God is omnipotent. How can we say that the spirit is omnipotent while we have said that he is not God?
Okay. So Acts 1, 8, 18. Read it.
It says, now this man purchased a veil with the reward of iniquity. And holding headlong, he passed asunder in the midst, and all his bones flashed out.
Chapter 1, verse 8.
Yeah. It says, but he shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and he shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
So, Brother Peter, now let us get maybe what you are asking. Let us get this. The spirit is powerful, all powerful.
Yeah.
God is all powerful, and his spirit is powerful. The Father is omnipresent, but he is omnipresent by his spirit.
Omnipotent. I was speaking about
omnipotent. And yeah, I started by being omnipresent.
Yeah.
He's omnipresent by his spirit. The Father is omnipotent.
Yeah.
And all these things, also the Son is, because he has given to the Son.
Yeah.
He is also omnipotent. The Spirit is omnipotent. You ask, how is the Spirit omnipotent, yet it is not a person?
Yeah.
A very good question. Now, the Spirit of God, it is his power. Did we see that?
Yeah.
It is his life. And now, how does it carry the power? Think about this. You are in the court. The judge is the one who passes sentence. Okay? And when he passes sentence, he says, Peter, you are released from prison. Or Sami, you are released from prison. His word is his power. His word either can condemn you or set you free. And the Spirit is the word of God. So when it comes out, it comes with that authority. The word of God is that authority. It is his. It is accompanied with that power. When he speaks, things happen. Look here. By the word of God, all things were created. He said, just let there be waters.
Yeah.
And there be, and you know that it is the Spirit that did that.
Yeah.
The Word will accompany with that power. So the Word is as powerful as the Father himself.
Mm-hmm.
Although the Word is not a person, as we will say a person is, but the Word from whom it coming from. Like, have somebody ever told you a story? And it affected you.
Yeah.
Either you were happy or you became sad.
Yeah.
Who made you, sir? The person or the words?
The person, the words.
I get different answers, I know. No. Not that he should try. I'm asking you, have you ever had a story?
Yeah.
Like, I can tell you a very sad story. I was coming to Rongo. I was going to Maseno just some days ago. And I was traveling with my neighbor. This is very amazing. Just a neighbor at home. And yesterday, my mother calls me. I was with this brother, seated on the same chair with him. He has a family, one wife and a child. A child has done standard 8. I was with him, we were storytelling, he paid the fee, he told me, I'm going to Maseno, that's where he works. I was going to Maseno, I also went there and bought what I wanted and went back to the house last week, before I came here, this week. And then my mother called me yesterday and said, do you know what? But Enoch has hung himself, he has committed suicide. I was like, what? What is happening? And I was with him in the vehicle, he doesn't tell me there's any problem that he's facing. He's so jovial and we are just storytelling, and then the next day I come here and then he has committed suicide. I feel so sad. It was a sad story. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Ask you, has anyone ever told you a story?
Yeah.
How did you feel? Either sad or good.
Yeah.
But who made you either feel sad or happy?
You know, the story that I heard
yes.
made me to be sad.
The story? Yeah. What does the story contain?
The good news?
Yeah.
To contain the power.
Oh. It contains the power to alter how you feel.
Yeah.
You know, the person cannot make you sad.
No.
Because I cannot, I can just stand.
It's just a messenger.
The person can be standing here, but what will come out of his mouth
yeah.
will determine how your mind will feel, will determine how your body responds.
Yeah.
Yes. And so, you ask about God being omnipotent. God is omnipotent. When he speaks, the words comes with that power, and they can do something that God will do with his hands.
Yeah.
Whatever the word can do is what God can do with his hands.
Yeah.
But he chooses to use the words because they don't just come out as breath only. They come out with that power. So the word of God is omnipotent. God is eternal. His spirit is eternal. So the word, it carries that power. And that's how the word is omnipotent. The spirit is omnipotent because it carries the power of God. It doesn't just come as a breath. And you ask, is this now the spirit of the Father or the Son? But you understand the channel now.
Yeah, I understand.
The spirit comes from the Father, all powerful.
Yeah.
Able to do everything. To the Son.
Yeah.
And the Son gives us the spirit. Now when the Son gives us the spirit, do you know it is all that powerful?
Yeah.
When you are given the spirit, you have the gift of healing. God gives as he wishes.
Yeah.
If he sees that you are fit to carry the office of healing, he will give you that. To others, he gives the gift of what? Tell me the gift that we have of the Holy Spirit. The gift? The spirit of wisdom?
Yeah.
The spirit of knowledge.
Knowledge? The spirit of... What?
Understanding.
We have the spirit of healing. We have the gift of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The spirit of prophecy,
yeah.
There's somebody who have visions and dreams,
yeah.
The spirit of prophecy, the spirit of healing, and all this. So it, and you can lay your hands on somebody and say, be healed. And you know you are not the one healing. It's the spirit of God, the omnipotence of God working in you, the power of God working through you. You pray for somebody, even without touching them. You remember that Paul and Peter, their shadows could heal people. The handkerchiefs. Have you read those stories?
Mm-hmm.
In the book of Acts.
Mm-hmm.
What was accompanying their life? The power of God in them.
Yeah.
The omnipotence of the Lord was working in them and they could do all this work. So, When the spirit comes from God, it's not just a force. It is not just mere words. No, 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 no. It carries the power of God within. And Jesus says, he who believes in me will do greater works. Because my spirit, the spirit of the Father, will be in him. And so, let us not be confused. Is this the spirit of the Father or the spirit of the Son? No, Christ is the channel. We have been separated from God with sin. And so, we have the sinner, Jesus Christ, and the Father. In between, the Father gives the Spirit, the Son gives unto us. And then it goes back in that chain. And in closing, chapter 16 of John. John chapter 16 verse 15. We are going to read two verses and then we close with a word of prayer. I know we have gone past 1 hour.
And it says,
John
chapter 16 verse 15.
All things that the Father has are mine.
All things that the Father has
are mine.
Yes.
Therefore,
yes,
I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you.
Think a little bit, my brother. I don't want to reason for you.
No.
Reason for yourself. Christ is saying, everything that the Father has is mine.
Yeah.
How true is that? How will you interpret that? Who is now the owner?
The Father has the Father. All things, and his Son, he owns it. Because he has that right, because he is his Son.
Good. The Son... You know, Brother Peter, what you have, do you have a child, a son?
Yeah.
Not even a daughter. No. The daughter don't inherit anything.
Yeah.
You have a son.
Yes.
If anything happens in that boma, they will not even ask the wife of anything. They will ask, does he have a son? Because the son is the one that has, inherits whatever you have. It is his right to inherit everything, not a wife. A wife is a stranger. Mama, I'm sorry to use that language. You are a stranger where you are where you are married. You can be told anytime you leave and not be given a land. And unless the court favors you, that is how it shall remain. But a son cannot be thrown away from their home. A son inherits everything of the Father. So Christ is saying, you know what? What the Father has is what? Is mine by inheritance. I am his son. Who else can inherit but a son? So everything the Father has is
mine.
Omnipotence, omniscient, omnipresent. All of them are mine because I'm his son. The Father cannot deny me anything. Or you people, you deny your son's things.
No.
No, no, that's not how you should be behaving. In fact, the relationship between the Father and the Son should help us to understand family life.
Yeah.
Everything you own is for your family. You shouldn't be selfish, this is mine, this is mine. I'll not go into family life, but it's so deep into family life. Everything that the Father has is mine. Let us read the last verses as we close now. John chapter 5. These are closing verses. We were looking at the Holy Spirit. Who does it belong to? It is the Father's Spirit given to the Son, and it is sent to us, the believers. Let us come to an end of this session. John chapter 5.
Yes.
Now, start from verse 16.
Says, and therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day.
Yes.
My Father walketh, I took.
He thought you, and I walk.
And I walk.
Therefore the Jewish sought the more to kill him because he not only had broken the Sabbath but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with
the God.
Now, listen, look at me. The Jewish wanted to kill Jesus Christ because he said he was the Son of God. And saying that he is the Son of God made him equal with
him.
Now, if Peter said, I am your son, will anyone want to stone me?
Yeah, they can. Because they do not know.
Mama, what do you think? Will somebody want to stone me if I said I am the son of Peter?
No.
No.
Because you belong to your father.
I belong to my father. I'm not your son.
Okay.
So no one will want to kill me. But what if I continued claiming that I am your son and wanted to bring trouble? Will somebody want to kill me? If I continued saying that I'm his son and I wanted to cause trouble, will somebody want to kill me? No, he will not kill me. But look at the verse. They want to kill Jesus. Is it?
Yeah.
What did they understand about Jesus Christ saying that he is the Son of God? I'll rephrase it. Here is Jesus saying that he is the Son of God, and that makes him equal to God.
Yeah.
At what extent will people want to kill Jesus? Why should they want to kill Jesus?
Wanted to kill Jesus because he was just in Christ in himself with God.
Because he broke the Sabbath.
He broke the Sabbath, but let me make it to you a little simpler.
Mm-hmm.
If Christ says that he is a real son of God, this is what it means. And they interpreted it that he is equal to the Father by saying he's the Son, is it?
Yeah.
What it only means that Christ was a real son of God and the DNA of the Father was in him.
Yeah.
It is only the DNA that could make him equal with the Father. That the DNA of the Father was his DNA. That is the only thing, that your son is equal to you, not because of age, but because of the DNA.
Yeah.
If you go to the hospital and they find the DNA, your DNA is the DNA of your son, they'll say, this is the son of Peter in reality. And he is equal to Peter, not because of age, but because of the DNA. This is how the Jewish understood. This is how we understood them then. And that Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, this also doeth the Son likewise. So everything the Father does, also the Son?
The Son.
How is it possible that everything that the Father does, that the Son can do? Because he has all the powers of the Father. When he was begotten with the attributes of the Father. And one of those things is the Spirit of the Father dwelling in him that carries all the powers that are needed for the salvation of man. He says, for the Father loveth the Son and sheweth him all things that himself doeth, and he will shew him greater works than this, that you may marvel. For as the Father raises up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. Do you remember that it is the Holy Spirit that quickens our body? It is in Romans chapter 8. The Spirit of the Father quickens our body. And so he has given the Son to have that Spirit to quicken us. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son as Son, even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which has sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believe on him that sent me hath everlasting what?
Life.
And shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death to life. Verily, verily, I say unto you, that hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live.
Yeah.
They shall hear the voice and shall
live.
Genesis chapter 1 verse 2. The Spirit of God was upon the waters. The voice of God was upon the waters.
Yeah.
The Spirit was upon the waters.
Yeah.
And the Spirit created the Spirit of God. And it will create us.
Yeah.
It will give us life. The same Spirit that was on the waters, the same word, the same voice that is powerful, the voice of God, He has given the Son, and the Son is saying that this Spirit that was with the Father is with me, and I shall be able to give you life. Just as the Father spoke by voice, and things were created through me, and so also I'll create you by the voice, not anything else, by the Spirit. This is the Spirit of the Father given to the Son, and the Son giving unto us. No other thing, no three gods. Mama, I don't know what, I'll now just challenge you. What have you been believing about God, about Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit? Briefly, just in closing, as we pray. What have you been taught in your church? What do you believe? What do your church fellow church members
have? I've been taught of the Trinity of God.
Yes.
But now, I've understood.
Things are different? Are you getting things are different?
Yes. Yeah. The Spirit of God is God Himself.
It is the presence of God Himself, not another God. Yeah. And we don't have the Trinity of God, the Son. We have the Son of God. He was begotten by God and given unto us. He is not God the Son or another God on earth. We don't have another God, the Holy Spirit. No, we have the Father who is the only God, and He has a Son, and the Father has given the Spirit to the Son, and the Son gives us the Spirit. This is the truth. And we have found that whoever person doesn't believe in the Bible is not going to heaven. Unless it is out of ignorance. But after reading all these things and after having the verses, if you still believe in error, maybe we can read the last verse, John 17:17. I know you know this verse, but I want us just to read it in closing, because this is much important than anything else. John 17:17. Let us read it, then we pray.
To say,
yes.
Sanctify by telling through the truth.
Yes.
Thy word is true.
So, this word is what?
It's the truth.
If you believe in anything that is not in this word, it is?
True.
It is not truth. And can you be sanctified?
No.
You will not be sanctified. You can only be sanctified through what? Through the truth. May the Lord be with us, and we can bow down for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we say thank you for this session we have had about thy Spirit. We cannot exhaust everything, Heavenly Father. How we pray that you may continue revealing thyself unto us. And Father, we may only speak those things that are in thy word. Thank you for thy love and thy mercies. And thank you for giving Jesus Christ the comforter to comfort us when we need you. Your will continue to be done in our lives. It is in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.